Hello everyone, I want to welcome you to our first lesson of ICT Paper 1, and that's Introduction to Computing. It is presented by Okolong Sam. We know that ICT is composed of three papers: Paper 1, Paper 2, and Paper 3. But a student is expected to do only two papers, either Paper 1 and Paper 2, or Paper 1 and Paper 3. So here comes Introduction to Computing, which is the first topic in Paper 1. This topic will introduce you to computers, their uses, and their applications in various fields. By the end of this lesson, you should be able to describe the application of information and communication technologies, that's ICT, in a society. So, let's look at what we are supposed to learn under Introduction to Computing. One, we should be able to look at Introduction to Computers, where we shall be able to know more about computers. We should be able to talk about the world of ICT, describing what ICT is, and how is it beneficial to us. Implications of using ICT. So, in our first topic, we should be able to look at those three subtopics. That's Introduction to Computers, World of ICT, and lastly, Implications of using ICT. So let's begin with the first one, that is Introduction to Computers. Now, Introduction to Computers has also been broken down into five parts. And the first part, we shall be able to describe a computer. We shall be able to look at what a computer is in detail, identifying different parts of a computer and their uses. For this case, we are going to look at just basic parts, and at the end you will be able to add in more parts. We should be able to look at computer system components. We should also be able to make or to differentiate between information and data. Then lastly, under Introduction to Computers, we should be able to describe the information processing cycle. So let's begin with the first one, describing a computer. So for us to describe a computer, we need to know what a computer is. And therefore, a computer is an electronic device that accepts data input, processes it, output and stores it for future use. So when you are giving in a definition of computer, please make sure you have some words that you should not miss them out in your definition. For example, here, electronic device. Why do we call computer electronic device? Simply because it is made up of electronic components. For example, ICs, the transistors, etc. So make sure you have electronic device in your definition. Then the other words you must not miss out is the four major functions of the computer. The main function as to why the computers were developed, and one being inputting of data processing of data, outputting, displaying the data to the user, and storing it for the future use. So once you have those five words, you'll be able to come up with a full definition of a computer. So when you miss them out, your answer may be considered null. So, what are the characteristics of a modern computer? What makes a modern computer special? What makes a computer different from a human being? One is the speed. Computers operate at extremely high speeds. Their speed is measured in millions of instructions per second. So when you compare the way the computer works and the way a human being works, the computers are able to work at a high speed. For example, when you assign a computer an operation, like to perform for you the division, and you give that very number to a human being, you realize that a computer will take less time as compared to a human being. Then two is the accuracy. Computers can process large amount of data without making any mistakes or errors. Always, the errors or the mistake made is as a result of human errors. What you enter into the computer is what the computer will do for you. So sometimes we refer this accuracy to giggle. Garbage in, garbage out. What you give to the computer is what it gives you out. So don't expect to give it bread and you want it to give you out soda. So it must be able to give you back bread. Then three, diligence. Computers are diligent, that is to say, they have the ability to perform similar tasks without getting tired and bored. For example, when you go to the industrial robotics, like those in car assembly lines, you will find that these computers are in car assembly line robots. Robots are used for assembling those parts. You can find that there's a robot assigned simply for tightening the bolts, and it will do that task from morning to morning without complaining. So therefore, computers are capable of doing similar tasks without getting tired and bored. Storage. Modern computers can store a large amount of data permanently. A user can use this data anytime. You can store any type of data in computer, like text, graphics, pictures, videos, etc. So modern computers do come with a large storage capacity, and I think for now you can even store the data up to a terabyte. Versatility. Computers are capable of doing very many tasks competently at the same time. They can carry out a number of different tasks at the same time and in different ways. For example, you may be having work, you are typing in the computer, and at the same time, you may be listening to music using that very computer. So that means that the computers have that ability of performing more than one task at a time. We also have automation or spontaneous. Computers work automatically. They do not need anyone to supervise them in order to perform programmed routine. The moment you program the computer to do something, it will perform it automatically without you supervising it. Artificial intelligence. The computers are so intelligent in that they can respond to our command and providing a solution. You can command it to do something, it will do it and it gives you back the answer. Then lastly, retrieval. Computers are capable of retrieving information perfectly. Any information stored can be recalled as long as you require it. So that means that you are capable of copying back the information that has been stored in a computer. So those are the characteristics of modern computers. Those are the features that make computers to be different from human beings. So a question may come, why do you think computers? Why should you use a computer to monitor a patient in the hospital rather than using a nurse? So you derive those answers simply from these characteristics. The kind of exams we have nowadays requires you to know how to state the points and also explain them, because someone may simply ask you to explain each of the following as applied to the computer, maybe diligence, artificial intelligence, so you must be able to talk about it again. Alright. After looking at that, let's look at the basic parts of a computer. So, I've come up here with only four, but there are many. So you should be able to state others. So the first one, we have what is called the system unit. As you can see here, this is the system unit. Though some people call it CPU, it is very wrong. This is just a box. It's not the CPU. Then we have the monitor. As you can see there, we have the keyboard. And lastly, we have the mouse. So those are the four basic parts of the computer. So what do they do? What are their functions? System unit. This is the part that houses the brain of the computer. It is not the brain of the computer, but it is the part that houses the brain of the computer, and the brain of the computer is a CPU. The system unit also houses other devices called the drives, and the drives are used to store, record, and read the data. The computer system unit is made up of the internal components like motherboard, memory chip, that's RAM and ROM, CPU, expansion slots, adapter cards, the cooling systems, ports, databases, internal cables, etc. So in simple terms, a system unit simply houses the internal components of the computer. The keyboard. The keyboard is used to enter data and instructions into the computer, and it is referred to as a peripheral device. What are the peripheral devices? Peripheral devices are devices that are attached to the computer system units externally through the ports, and the keyboard is one of them. And we have seen here that the keyboard enables a user to enter data and instructions into the computer. Therefore, a keyboard is an input device. The mouse, as another part, is the pointing device that enables the user to execute commands. It is used to control the arrow displayed on the screen, and that's why we call it a pointing device. So you can see my arrow moving on this screen, and it is controlled by the use of a mouse. Then lastly, the monitor. The monitor looks like a television and is a device used to display information to the user. It is called a monitor simply because it enables the user like you to monitor or see what's going on in the computer. So those are the four basic parts of the computer and their uses. So you can go ahead and also list other parts. Alright. Okay. Next, we want to look at the computer system components. What is a computer system? We know that a system is simply interrelated components or a combination of components that perform a specific task. So therefore, a computer system refers to the combination of interrelated components that work together to process data into information. Those components that you will combine in order for the computer to produce, to work on the data and convert it into the information. And some of those components, we have four. We have the hardware, that's the computer hardware. We have the computer software, humanware, or users like you, data, or information. So, you must have all the four in order for you to come up with the information. In case one is missing, the three cannot work to come up with the goal of processing data into information. So from today onwards, you should know that even you, the user, you are very, very important part of the computer. Because without you, the computer may not be able to work, because you are the one going to provide the command. So let's look at each by each. The first one is the computer hardware. The computer hardware is a term used to describe all the various physical devices of a computer. Computer hardware components are tangible. That means that those parts of the computer or the elements, the components of the computers that you can touch easily is the hardware. For example, you may have the mouse, you can touch it. You can have the monitor, you can touch it. So computer hardware is categorized into four main categories that includes input devices that are used for entering data into the computer, for example, the keyboard, the mouse, the cameras, etc. Another category is called processing devices that are used simply to convert data into information. They are used in the process of processing. And the main component there is the microprocessor chip, CPU. And then we also have storage devices in case you want to keep your information after processing it. For example, the hard disk, the CDs, the flash disk, etc. Then the last category is output devices. Because after the computer processing the information, it has to be displayed to the final users. And we have examples like the monitor, the projectors, the printers, etc. Depending on the type of the information that you want to display. Then the second component is the computer software. Software is a term for electronic instructions that tell your computer how to perform a task. It is just the instruction. So, in our body, if you compare a computer with our body, software is our mind, because it is our mind that tells us what to do. So therefore, our mind is the software. So software should be able to tell the computer what and how to work. Computer software can be grouped into two, that is system software and the application software. We shall look at that in detail. The other component is the humanware or the computer users. Computer user refers to the people who operate and initialize instructions to the computer system, just like you. They design and develop computer systems, operate the computer hardware, create software, and establish procedures for carrying out it. That's why I said, without you, the computers will not be able to work. You are one of the most important part in a computer system. There are two kinds of computer users. We have ordinary users, and these are the people without much technical knowledge of computers, but they use computers to produce information for professional or personal tasks, or enhancing learning, or just to have fun. Now, some of the examples of ordinary users are you, the students, the typist, or the secretary. They can use computers to produce the information, but they do not have the technical knowledge. In case the computer gets spoiled, they cannot open it and repair. Then, the other category of the user is the professional user, who is a person in profession involving computers, who has had formal education in the technical aspect of the computer. Example, computer programmers, webmasters, people who come up with the websites. So for them, they have either the certificates, they have either the... So they took computer as a course. Computer data and information. Data refers to the raw facts and figures used to create information. In other words, data is simply raw material for coming up with the information. This is entered into the computer by a user via input device in a form suitable for processing. That means that data has to be entered into the computer in that format that is suitable for processing. Data may consist of characters, symbols, sounds, graphics, and videos. So you may enter, data can be entered in form of characters, those are the text, the symbols, the sound, you can simply just talk, graphics, and videos. On the other hand, computer information refers to the processed data that makes meaning and is useful. So after processing your data, you come up with what is called the computer information. So where students always make mistake is when they are differentiating between data and the information. Since we have said information refers to the processed data, then a student will tell you data refers to unprocessed information. Please, at this level, we are taking you to be a person who can think. Leave that for the primary students. So for you, when you are depreciating data and information, data simply refers to raw facts and figures entered into the computer to come up with information, whereas information refers to the processed data that makes meaning and is useful. That means that an information must be useful, it must have meaning. For example, the figure that we are seeing here, 1008206, may be input as data. At this, it is just a raw material. At this stage, it has no meaning. Like for me, I don't see any meaning. I may not even be able to read this. But once this same figure is converted into the format 10/08/2000, it now becomes useful. It now has some meaning because it is now a date. Alright. Computer information is organized into files, which are collections of data grouped together and given a name. Okay. A file that a user can open and use is often called a document. Alright. Now, these are some of the examples of data and information. You have letters. Those letters can form words. For example, A, B, C, D, up to Z are data. In case they form a word, they become information. Symbols, and those symbols can make a report, a letter, an essay to form information. So, it is from data where you get information. So lastly, let us look at the information processing cycle. Information processing cycle is a series of steps that computer follows to process data into information. Series of steps, activities of steps that a computer follows to process data into information. So before you come up with an information, there must be some steps to be followed before that happens. And some of these steps include data inputting, processing, outputting, then lastly storage. And what is called a cycle, the steps must be followed from the first one to the last one. So in case you are answering an examination and they ask you for this series, for the information processing cycle, make sure you begin with the first one and you end with the last one. Don't begin with the last one and you end with the first one. No. So the first one is input or data input, where a user enters data into the computer by maybe use of the keyboard, the mouse, etc. Then processing, where the computer's processing components perform actions on or with the data to come up with the information. After that, the computer provides results of its processing. So that means that it displays what it has come up with. Then lastly, the computer stores the results of its processing such that it can be used some other time. So, looking at the parts of the computer that we looked at, in what stage do you think each computer part would be listed under? For example, when you look at input, you can list there the keyboard, the mouse, processing. So that will be your assignment. The processing information cycle can be indicated, as you can see there, where you have data being input, processed, can be stored, taken back for the processing. Output must also be there. So thank you for your time. for today, we are ending there. In our next video, we shall be able to look at the world of ICT. Thank you so much.